Say you really, really wanted to kill someone, a cyclist for example, and you also wanted to kill everyone from the same planet as him, you know, just to be sure. Using nukes would take forever and we don't have all day. We're gonna need the most effective planet erasers theoretically possible. Join me as we search the universe for the most efficient genocide tools there is. It'll be a great time for all ages. Starting small with a planet about half the size of Earth, this one I guess we could spend the time to just nuke into oblivion if we really wanted to, but not if you wanted to make it back home in time for Simpsons. So for this first planet we'll use the hot stepmom to nukes, antimatter bombs. I'm sure you've heard of this one before. Nuclear power plants work by smashing a neutron into Uranus, a uranium atom, which then splits into two new atoms and more neutrons that continue the process. The total mass of all the new particles combined is less than the original mass of the uranium atom and the neutron by about 0.1%. This mass got converted, according to Einstein's equations, into energy, mostly in the form of the new particle's kinetic energy, but also some other bullshit. If you do this in a super fast and uncontrolled manner, like Jerome Powell printing money, you've got yourself a nuke.
Huh?
I mean a nuke. An antimatter bomb works similarly. When an antimatter atom comes into contact with a regular atom, they both completely annihilate, releasing 100% of their mass into energy instead of the 0.1% in nukes. Really makes you feel inadequate, doesn't it? Given that we don't want to spend the time dropping bomb after bomb, it'd be better if we could just make one big bomb. For us to create an explosion so big that we won't have to worry about any more grown-ass men walking around with ridiculous-looking helmets on, it would need to contain about 2 tons of antimatter. Little Boy, the bomb that wiped out all the cyclists in Japan, weighed almost 10 tons, although most of that weight was not in uranium but all the other shit that made it work. It only had about 64 kilos of actual uranium, and given the cost of antimatter, your ass can forget about using this kind of weapon anytime soon. A 2-ton antimatter bomb would basically disintegrate an entire country, leaving only dust and ashes, and the rest of the planet would slowly be dying from the coming ice age caused by all the crap launched into the atmosphere. But this poses a problem. If the planet not only had cyclists, but also intelligent life forms, they might try and escape the planet, given that it's doomed and all. So to solve this, we either need to make the bomb really, really strong, like Jim Cramer's ability to tank my stocks just by saying their name on television, or step it up to the next level of doomsday weapons, electron beams. Suggested by Kurskin fucking... Yeah, these fucking guys again. Building a particle accelerator about 100,000 kilometers long would enable you to bombard planets with insane amount of electrons from very far away. The inhabitants of this planet wouldn't know what hit them. As the electron beam reaches the planet, nothing interesting happens. Just like in your day-to-day life. But not long thereafter, you would begin to feel sick, as the high-energy electrons has been hitting your cells and your DNA, completely destroying you from the inside. So while this means a slow and painful, unhumane death for our enemies, it's not like we care very much. A few days after bombarding the planet with electrons, the job is done. How safe are you feeling under that helmet now, Pete? Good luck sipping that mocha fucking latte without your DNA, you son of a bitch! Another way to kill a civilization, if you're cruel enough, is to drop down large amounts of Counter-Strike 2 copies. It took 11 years for them to create the exact same game, except they killed B-hopping. Go fuck yourself, Valve. Next up on the list is Strange Matter Slingshots. Out of the 6 different quarks that exists, protons and neutrons, in other words like everything we see, are made up of just the up and down quarks, while the rest are more exotic and hard to come by. One of these quarks is literally called the Strange Quark, and the behavior of this particle is a lot like me on crystal meth.
I'm a hacker, I've seen some of these documentaries, I ain't building none of that. Hey, the game government ain't no getting no one in the mass sample, not getting my 3D.
Very fucking hard to understand. When a star reaches the end of its life and it collapses in on itself, it can either become a black hole or, if the inward forces are not quite strong enough, it becomes a neurodivergent star. I mean a neutron star. The electrons orbiting the atom's core gets pushed inward so hard they collide with the protons, turning the entire atom into just neutrons, leaving you with a super dense celestial body made up of nearly only neutrons. As you dive deeper and deeper into this weird ball of neutrons, all kinds of theories exist of how the arrangement of the neutrons changes depending on the pressure, and at the very core, the pressure may be so strong that the neutrons may sort of melt and create a bath of up and down quarks. If the pressure is great enough, some quarks may be converted into strange quarks. Normally, any of the more exotic quarks would quickly decay since they're not stable enough to make up regular matter. But inside the core of a neutron star, they're more comfortable than a politician on Epstein Island. This mix of up, down, and strange quarks is called strange matter, and may be the most stable form of matter in the universe. So stable, in fact, that anything that comes into contact with it may be converted into strange matter itself. The only way that this shit can get out of the neutron star is if two of them collide and sling tiny pieces called strangelets out in all directions. Now, don't get too caught up in the interesting science of it all. Remember, we're here to kill people. Not learn stuff. Kill people. Catching one of these strangelets is no easy task, because they can be very, very tiny, and remember that you can't touch them, cause... well, then you're dead, bitch. But with my magical gravitational sensor machine thingy, we'll be able to detect their gravitational footprints, since even though they are very small, they still have the density of a neutron star's core. A strangelet the size of a sugar cube would weigh about 1 trillion kilos, or 1 billion tons, which is about as much as your mom, or a mountain of your mom. Once you find it, you now have to carefully contain it. You do so by giving it gentle pushes, by basically shooting things at it until you have it at a standstill. Now, once you've decided to launch this 1 trillion kilo sugar cube at someone, it does become a bit more of a hassle than just bombing the shit out of somebody. Since it's impossible to touch it without dying, sort of like cocaine, God, I love that shit, you basically have to accelerate the object by either shooting things at it once again, or slingshot it around other objects with large gravitational fields to get it up to speed. Once it hits the target planet, though, it'll be well worth the effort. The target planet would quickly transform every last atom into strange matter, and you would see the planet shrink as it becomes more dense, until the whole planet has been transformed and is now the size of a 10-meter sector. Now, the good thing about this weapon is that you can reuse the same ammunition, although the same strangelet will now weigh almost 6 septillion kilograms, assuming the planet you attacked is about the same size as Earth. But no matter the size of the strangelet, it's still very slow. The planning needed in order to accelerate and aim the strangelet in the right direction is very time-consuming. I mean, I can't even plan a wank. I mean, there's just so many options out there. I never even finished the planning stage. I mean, what the fuck? And even when done amazingly well, the strangelet will only be traveling at a tiny fraction of the speed of light, meaning it will take ages before arriving at its destination. To speed things up a bit, we head to the endgame weapon, a portable quasar. A quasar is a supermassive black hole at the center of the galaxy that is spinning rapidly, has a strong magnetic field around its corona, and is consuming matter faster than a typical American. The material getting pulled into the black hole aligns itself and forms an accretion disk. As this material spirals into the black hole at insane speeds, the material collides with itself over and over again, and the friction causes it to heat up to about 100,000 degrees Celsius. This causes the quasar to be thousands of times brighter than entire galaxies with 100 billion stars. Due to the spin and the magnetic field, jets of ionized matter are concentrated and shot out of both poles. These jets travel at nearly the speed of light and can get so large that they dwarf entire galaxies, as they can stretch for hundreds of thousands of light years. One of the most extreme cases is TUN 618, with a mass of 40 billion suns. In fact, it's so large that a new size category has been proposed. Case of holes. It shines as strong as 140 trillion suns, so bright that we can't even see the galaxy that it's in the center of because it outshines its entire host galaxy by so much. If moving and aiming a strangelet with a weight of a few septillion kilograms got you afraid of a hard day's work, doing the same thing for a 100 duodecillion kilogram quasar might be pretty off-putting. And yes, duodecillion is a real word. There's an entire list, actually. Who the hell makes these words up? But fear not, plebs, even though weaponizing a quasar sounds tough, it can be done and the reward will be well worth it. In order to move such an object, we will need several large stellar engines as proposed by Professor Matthew Kaplan in his paper describing a method on how to move stars. For stars, these stellar engines get powered by a Dyson sphere around the star that refocuses the light into a small portion of the sun's surface, heating it up to extreme temperatures, causing even more mass than usual to be lifted off of the sun's surface in the regular explosions that take place. That mass is then captured by the machine using large electromagnetic fields that funnel the mass into chambers that separate out the hydrogen and the helium, which is then used for nuclear fusion. Radioactive oxygen is shot out the back, and the hydrogen is accelerated using particle accelerators and then shot into the star. These two beams and the gravity of the sun balances each other out perfectly, like telling your girl to do the dishes 1 second and then handing her flowers in the next should in theory lead you back to neutral. Because of this balance, the engine stays at a stable distance from the star and propels it forward. Replace the star with the accretion disk and you've got your black hole transportation. Only problem is again the mass. Moving a quasar would require a lot of these stellar engines, and big ones too. But once you've oriented the quasar to your liking, you can wipe out billions of planets in one go. Depending on the distance to the planets and the target galaxy, the populations would A. notice an interesting new bright light and radio source in the sky, B. have all of their telecommunications infrastructure knocked out, C. die within years to weeks from radiation exposure and burns, or D. be instantly fucking vaporized. A portable quasar may be a bit overkill if you're up against a mere single civilization. This weapon is meant for larger scale infestations where the spread has gone too far to handle using more targeted strikes. Here's a funny fact about quasars. Quasars that are aimed directly at the observer will appear a lot brighter due to certain relativistic effects that are super easy to understand for me personally, but for you not so much. These quasars are instead called blazars, and given billions of galaxies in the universe, it's a guarantee that thousands of them contain these blazars, aiming the most dangerous weapon in the entire universe right at our faces, and the bullets has already been fired. But fear not, as the closest blazar is about 400 million light years away, well out of range for even the strongest of quasars. And as long as all of us adults on this planet don't put a helmet on when riding our bikes, I'm sure no one out there will bother to move it any closer.